And if my words unjustly speak. Welcome to the 3% podcast brought to you by Open Letter and the University of Rochester. This is Chad Post from Open Letter Books, and today we are doing a special edition that's all about John Barth, in particular the Sot-Weed Factor and Chimera, both of which were just re-released by Dalkey Archive Press as part of the Dalkey Essentials series. And I'm joined today by two guests. The first is John Domini, who is an Italian-American author, translator, and critic, widely published, author of, and this might need to be updated, 3 short story collections, 4 novels, a 2021 memoir, a book of criticism, a book of poetry, and a memoir translated from Italian. Correct?
Yes. That's wonderful. Thank you.
The reason that we were joking ahead of time, that I wanted to use your, thank you for joining us, first of all, but wanted to use your Wikipedia entry to do your bio introduction, is that there's a section in here that's called influences. And this is just, I mean, overall awesome. Domini has studied with John Barth and Donald Barthelme, writing critical essays on both. Moviola is dedicated to those two, plus Stanley Elkin, the poet Anne Sexton, all teachers of Domini. Domini also claims Toni Morrison, Gilbert Sorrentino, and Jamie Gordon as influences, as well as European influences such as Italo Calvino, Jenny Erpenbeck, and Sebald. Now, ironically, the other book that just got re-released by Dalkey in the Essential series is Mulligan Stew by Gilbert Sorrentino, which we're doing a separate podcast on that started the same day that we're recording this one, in which we're doing reading about 65 pages every single week for 8 weeks and discussing and breaking down The Joy of Mulligan Stew. So you are like center of my world in terms of the books that are coming out right now and their influence on your life. Now, also
Should
along-
I respond?
Yeah, go for it. You respond and then I'll introduce Max.
I think some of this is just the luck of my birth, where I was born and where I went to college. But I really must wave this wonderful book by Max Besora, who is joining us. And the program at Boston University where I studied, they had a far-sighted administrator, man in charge, a poet nobody knows now, but he brought in these great people.
Yeah.
And some of them I remain friends with. Sorrentino, a lot of those others, I discovered them much later through reading, which is the way you should discover a writer.
Yeah.
But thank you for that gracious introduction.
No problem. So we're also joined by Max Besora, who is the author of, do you have 4 novels now?
I think so.
I think so too. I think the bio that we have for the book that we published has you at 3, including Volcano, and then the book that was the first book of yours to be translated and published in English, which is was translated by Mara Faye Letham.
No, 5 novels.
Five novels. You gotta catch up. 5 novels, but including the one that's available in English that, John, you're referring to, The Adventures and Misadventures of the Extraordinary and Admirable Joan Orpí, Conquistador and Founder of New Catalonia, which received the 2018 City of Barcelona Prize for Catalan Literature. That book was translated, as I mentioned, by Mara Faye Letham and won the first inaugural USA-Spain Prize for translation from books from Spain. So congratulations to both of you for that. And yeah, so John, I should say too, Max is also the author of the introduction to the new edition of Sot-Weed Factor that came out from Dalkey essentially this month, in which they're part of the reprinting process. And I can talk about that whole process as we go. But I'm curious just to start, like,
my compliments to Max on an excellent introduction. I read it. I have it saved. I may even print it out.
I have it
saved in a file, and maybe I want to print it out and put it with the book.
It is a great introduction. Thank you again, Max, for writing that for us.
Thank you.
So I guess, Max, let's start with you. How did you come to Barth? So how did you come, how did you end up becoming a Barth fan? How did you end up loving the Sot-Weed Factor? What's your what's your background and your appreciation?
As a writer, I had a lot of influence from the North American literature since I was a teenager. And I started with the beatniks, you know, Kerouac and William Burroughs, all these people. And that led me to to Thomas Pynchon, Donald Barthelme, John Barth. And also the I saw a connection with the with these North American authors to the Latin American authors like Argentinian Jorge Luis Borges and Cortázar, and then the Cubans such as Lezama Lima or Alejo Carpentier, which are called the neo-Baroque literature, which is very related to the postmodernism North America. And I see all this constellation of authors that were writing, you know, on the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And somehow, of course, it's on my age, but I was more interested in those authors from that past or that moment of life that my contemporary authors. And why is that? I think it's because those authors were more radical in their experimentation and looking for freedom in literature and new ways of expressing than most of the literature that it's been doing nowadays, which is most close to mimetic realism and you know, like this kind of what I called therapy literature. The people talk about themselves like if they are in therapy or something, no? And I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in, you know, in imagination, creativity, experimentation. And this kind of literature I only find in those authors from the 60s or 50s or, you know. And in that way, I wanted to write a historical novel, which is the adventures of Joan Orpí. And I found out that John Barth had this book, you know, that I didn't read at the time. So I read it and, you know, it was like, whoa, I want to do this, you know. I want to do this, but with my story, which was also about a character who existed in the real history. And it was about a Catalan like me who went to the New World in the 17th century. So I thought, whoa, I need some, every time that I write a book, I need some backup, some books that really inspire me to write my own book, right? And because, you know, literature has always have to be connected with the tradition, no? And so I found all this bunch of books that were before my book. And, you know, so I can follow a line, a historical line between all these books. And I started with John Barth, but of course, all these started with the Quixote, you know, Spanish author Cervantes, which John Barth is very influenced to in order to make this book. And wow. So you have all this historical line that starts with Cervantes with the modern novel, which is the Quixote, and which contains metafiction already. And then it goes with Tristram Shandy, Jacques Le Fataliste from Diderot, and all these kind of books. I don't know, The Manuscript Found in Zaragoza, written by Potocki, which is a Polish author, or I don't know, Gargantua from Rabelais, right? There's this, all these, Candide from Voltaire, to all these books through history that seems to be cousins or brothers, no? And one led to the other, right? And I think the history of literature is this, you know, one book influenced another, and they are all related. And it's very interesting to see that literature doesn't have, you know, doesn't have age. It doesn't matter if it was written in the 15th century or the 20th century. It doesn't matter, you know, they are all related in the same constellation. And so when I wrote my own novel, I had all these novels in mind, and the John Barth, the Sot-Weed Factor was one of them too. And I think, you know, you cannot write without all these stories behind you that goes with you all together too, no? And it's in your own book, you know, somehow. I don't know what you think about this, but that's, for me, it's like
absolutely
this.
I want to transition and ask you some questions, John, and follow up on that. But for anyone who's listening who's not familiar with the Sot-Weed Factor, in brief, this is set in the late 1600s and is like truly a baroque, over the top very funny story of Ebenezer Cook going to the new land, going to America to take over a tobacco plantation in Maryland, and adventures, chaos, prostitutes, lots of like physical comedy jokes, lots of just outrageous ideas and conversations. And there's more plot things we could get into. But one of the things that's worth noting is that it is written in a faux dialect, like a sort of like mocking imitation of what that speech and what that speech looks like the 1600 speech is, particularly as it's written. So there's lots of like quotation marks that cut off words, things that are like inflected to be like that, but it's not obviously not accurate. And that was one of the big things that influenced, that I see as a connection point between Sot-Weed Factor and Joan Orpí, is that in Orpí, in your book, Max, there are like the dialect is also just created and invented and like inconsistent and wild and funny in that way. And there's such a freedom to that voice. And so for anyone who hasn't read John Barth and might be intimidated by like the sheer size of Sot-Weed Factor, trust me that once you start reading, it's just laughs. Like it's really, really, really funny. So John, I want to ask you, like, how did you come to, so you studied with Barth, and I want to ask you to talk about that, but I also curious, like, where you rank Sot-Weed Factor in terms of his books, because Barth wrote, what is it, like 20 some different books, including most recently.
But it's put 15. Isn't that something? I should know that. I should have that.
And we just had Postscripts, the collection of his shorter pieces, and mostly fiction, but also like some essays that came out through Dalkey last fall, maybe. And it's a new one.
A nice little book. It's nothing of weight like this one, both literal and figurative weight. Well, I was going to read just a bit of what he had to say, just a bit of the dialogue, so people would get an idea. The dialogue imitates late 16th century conversation. It's not that far. If you've read the most famous book in the tradition would be Tom Jones by Henry Fielding.
Yeah.
But, you know, Tobias Smollett, who I've only read tiny bits of, that has some of the same language. And here in English is the language. He said, for fee, then, this is one man who happens to be, of course, in a disguise, talking to Ebenezer Cook, the author of the poem, The Sot-Weed Factor, and also the main character of this book, Ebenezer Cook. And Ebenezer Cook is himself a kind of a disguised figure. He is not the real Ebenezer Cook, who in fact published a long poem called The Sot-Weed Factor in 1708 or 09. And nobody had ever heard of it till John Barth discovered it. Somebody, because the poet lived where he lived in Maryland. Okay, Ebenezer Cook, who pretends to be Ebenezer Cook here, is being interrogated by a figure who he knows at the moment as a guy named Sawyer, but Sawyer turns out to be somebody else, his great part nemesis, part tutor, part friend, so many things, Henry Burlingham. And so Sawyer smiles, belike it once enlarging. Okay, I better. Ebenezer starts by saying, thou art indeed the very voice and breath of reason, and I'm honored to be your neighbor. My cup runneth over, Sayer smiled, belike it once enlarging. You see, the pun is embedded there. 'Tis larger now than when I left London. Thou art no mean teacher. For a fee, then, if I'm thy tutor, ye may pay me out in verse, Sayer replied. As you wish, Ebenezer laughed, and on like that. One phrase in the old language, the pretense of old language, one phrase that recurs is willy-nilly, and it becomes a recurring refrain. People say it in various ways. Will he, nil he, will she, nil he, will you, nil I, that sort of thing. They say it in various ways. And it becomes very, very easy to read and enjoyable. And in fact, that scene, which I gave you just a tiny taste of, ends with probably Ebenezer's best quatrain and Sayer revealing who he actually is in costume. So, that's how you read it. It reads very well. The book has been attacked for being an inaccurate representation of how people talked at the end of the 17th century. And of course, this is absolute nonsense, that attack. It's not supposed to be that accurate. It's a work of fiction questioning the whole idea of history and what we know about the past and what we know about each other.
Yeah.
I don't think I answered your question.
That's okay.
I think your question was, where do I rate it? I rate it very highly. Is it way up?
No, but that's the interesting thing of what you read, this piece of page that you read, is that Barth uses a technique of the Baroque literature, which in Spanish it's called trampantojo. It's a composed word of two words, which means a trap in the eye. And it means that in the Baroque art and literature and whatever, it was very common to play with the disguise, that you never know who is really who, you know? It's like a carnival where people wear masks and you never know who's behind. And Barth plays during the whole novel with this ambiguity of the characters. So you never know who is who at the end and who's speaking at the end, because the novel starts with one narrator, but it changes in the middle of the book to another narrator, and then starts the confusion, which is, it's the same confusion that is saying, you know, you cannot trust this book. This is not history. This is fiction. And we are playing with words, and novel is just playing with words. You know, it's a game of the language. And then, so you cannot trust fiction, you know, and this advice, it's because, you know, still nowadays people think that what you read is real. And this is very dangerous, because it can go to, misleadings and strange situations, right? Which authors can go into court because they wrote something that it was just fiction, but people thought that it was real, you know? And so Barth all the time is playing with this between fantasy and reality, and also about the language, as you said, no, that it's not the real English of that time, you know? It's a fictional English, which is okay. It has to be like this, you know. Barth is watching history ironically, and he plays with this tradition. He knows the tradition, the literary tradition, and he plays with it. So it's at the same time a homage to the previous books, such Quixote or Tom Jones, but it's at the same time it's a satire of these books, you know, and the previous books that talks about traveling and, you know, and at the same time it's like the Arabian Nights. It's a story inside a story, you know. I think that's what
comes up again and again.
Yeah.
And of course, gambling is all about the bluff, and does he really have the hand?
Exactly.
Is there a hidden card somewhere up his sleeve? Mm-hmm. But
and it's, you know. it's a historical book, but also is making fun of history, and that what makes this book so modern. You know, it never, you know, sometimes when I read John Dos Passos or some other writers from the lost generation, sometimes it's a little bit, and even the beatniks, especially Kerouac, I read it now and it's like, you know, when I read it when I was a teenager, it was okay. But then when you grow up, you see these kind of books a little bit old fashioned. But John Barth never gets old, you know. You read it now and it's the same probably that when it was written, you know, because he knows that literature is, it doesn't have any age or caducity, you know, time, you know, and he plays with the whole history of literature, and so it never gets old, you know. It's like the Quixote, you can read it now and it's never, it never gets old, you know. It's plenty modern. And a lot of books that it was written 10 years before, it's already, they are already old, you know. That's weird, right?
I agree. A lot of Kerouac is very hard to take now. And I also a lot of beats. I worshipped at the altar of Allen Ginsberg for a while. I thought he was wonderful. And he's, sure, he's not bad.
Yeah.
Far be it from me to say that, but
no.
Barth would be at the other end of the spectrum from most of the beats. He has a very different notion of the calling that is writing. I'm not sure. Did we have about an hour?
We have, yeah.
That's an hour. Because now, at some point, I've got to bring up an entirely different reading of this book. Love Max's introduction, and it means the world to me. I imagine it would mean the world to John Barth to speak to somebody so powerfully across cultures. But I'm going to bring up a different reading of this book that I don't think denies anything that we've said so far. But the book is not just about art. It's about, after all, a man who claims he's a virgin and has always been a virgin. This is essential to Ebenezer Cook's story.
Mm-hmm.
He's a virgin at age 30 and a virgin the whole time. He goes to Maryland, the colony of Maryland, and meets, among others, many women who, well, not maybe not many, but a number of women who are willing to take his virginity. And there is a love story that runs through it. Max mentions the love story in his preface. Joan Toast is her name. By the way, great names.
Yeah.
Barth invented all the names, but the actual historical ones, like Ebenezer Cook. Joan Toast, what a name. Henry Burlingham really has the punch, the necessity. And there's a pun in Burlingham that I finally figured out with the help of a later Barth novel. But I am going to argue, if it's all right, for the moral quality of this book. It's about a man who claims to be a virgin and loses his virginity before he loses his virginity at the very end of the book. I brought it up. So I think about time. Max, how do you feel about it? If I bring up a counter reading to your reading, I don't think it undoes your reading. I think it adds to it. What do you think, Max? You mind?
It's okay for me.
All right. At the end of the book, and I can say this without spoiling the plot. It's impossible to spoil the plot. There's so much plot. But at the end of the book, there's a court case. There's a court case sort of rigged up in the estate that may be Ebenezer Cook's estate if things get straightened out. And it is rigged up. It's just a few people. One of them is the governor of Maryland insisting on this and that. And eventually an essential document, essential to the case and essential to Ebenezer and Henry Burlingame's long search for John, for what happened between John Smith and Pocahontas, mm-hmm. the long secret of mystery that's hanging over everything. And it turns out that Joan Toast, by then sick, dying of venereal disease, much abused, Joan Toast has got it. And she says she's not going to give it to anybody. She says, look at me. Behold the fruits of my lustfulness. I'm sorry, the fruits of lustfulness, not her lustfulness. Lustfulness. And, you know, throughout this book, of course, we've seen men taking advantage of women in all sorts of ways. And it can be shocking. And I can tell a story about that, too. But behold the fruits of lustfulness, swived in my 12th year. Swived in English is one of those old words used again and again. You understand it from page 10, if not earlier. It means having sex, I suppose so. Keep it clean. Swived in my 12th year, poxed in my 20th, and dead in my 21st. She's still a young, very young thing here. Ravaged, ruined, raped, and betrayed. Women's lot is wretched enough at best. And this is, you know, what you could call the climax of the whole book, is her asserting her power and her place and the abuse that's been wrought upon her. Now she gets what she wants. She, in effect, emerges from the case the winner. But among the things she insists on is Ebenezer. Mm-hmm. And Ebenezer says, right, I'll go to bed with you, sick or not. Sure, I will. It is time for him to own up to his failures. And on the next page, even after his sister tells Ebenezer, you're the spirit of innocence, he says, that is the crime I stand indicted for, the crime of innocence. Our souls are born, not, that is the original sin our souls are born in, and Adam had to learn. He had to learn, in short, that he was innocent. Now, there's a lot more to be said. I don't want to dominate, but I'm suggesting that there is actually a moral argument here. It's handled with great humor, but it is one of the strongest assertions of Barth's feminist argument, the situation of Joan Toast. And that feminist argument recurs throughout his work, and it's unique almost in American literature, that a man argues so often he argues for a better place for women in society. And or at least he argues against their abuse by the current society. And I would say that is, as well as all the other things we're talking about, an essential element here, that Joan Toast partakes in all the games going on, but she winds up the worst loser, and Ebenezer has to recognize his innocence. He has to fall in order to become a whole man, to get anywhere on his journey, and of course to publish his one successful poem, The Sot-Weed Factor. So that's my argument. And I'd say, let me ask you this, Max, I'd say, for instance, it sets the book apart from Bolano's 2666, which I have only read in part. I've read in pieces, but clearly he too wants to say something about the abuse of women. And he too has all sorts of literary games going on, but it's not as pronounced. It's not as much a driving factor. But Bolano, I would describe as one of the inheritors of Barth. So you can go at my question either way. What do you think of my moral argument for the book? Or, you know, what about Barth's influence on others? And thank you for listening.
Well, I like your argument. I mean, because, you know, Barth and other writers like him, such Barthelme or Robert Cooper or Thomas Pynchon, you know, we're all put it in this bag called the postmodernism, which it has been many different lectures about this word, right? And many of them were negative in the sense that, you know, oh, postmodernism literature is like, it's nihilism and there's no sense at all and it's not connected to reality and it's escapist and you know, it leads to nothing and nobody. It's like a cul-de-sac, right? And that's why the postmodern literature, it's like old-fashioned now, no? And seems like nobody reads this kind of writers anymore because it's not related to the social issues that nowadays society needs. And, you know, we need to talk about the, you know, minorities and collectives, and which is okay too. Huh? But somehow these kind of writers were, you know, put aside. And I think it's because they were kind of, you know, they were too radical for the big firms, the big publishing houses, because of course they were not selling much, I guess. They were not bestsellers, except one or two books, maybe, you know, the Gravity's Rainbow or, you know, but all the others were like, you know, and like kind of a counterculture underground, something like that, or very academic, just for academics, or just writers for writers, you know.
Yeah.
It's the kind of writers that only writers read, which is, you know, I think it's a mistake. I mean, The Sot-Weed Factor is a very funny novel. Anybody can read it. And you don't have to understand everything, you know. And that's what postmodernist literature for me is about. It's just, you know, let's enjoy this book. Let's enjoy the language and you know, doesn't get too attached to rationality, you know, because it seems that nowadays literature has to have a very attachment to reality. And if you don't understand the plot, then it's not literature. It's not worth it. It's not a good book. But it's not about, fiction is not about that. You know, art is not about that. When you go to a museum and you see a cubism painting, you don't have to understand it. You just have to enjoy it, right? So it's the same with literature. Why it doesn't apply to literature, you know, that you can just read a book. You don't have to understand the book. You know, it's not necessary. You can enjoy it anyway, right? So in that way, I think postmodernism authors, they were accused of that you don't understand the whole plot. And partly it's true. I mean, I got lost reading The Sot-Weed Factor sometimes because the plot goes some twisted evil that, you know, you get lost. But so what? It doesn't matter. You know, you can just enjoy the book and enjoy the language and still go on, right? And so, well, about the moral in the story, I think Barthes is playing with this literature that the 18th century literature that had to be a moral in the story. But the moral in the John Barth, the Sot-Weed Factor, is more like a joke, because it's about a guy who never had sex, you know. And that's the funny thing, you know. You spend 1,000 pages seeing if he's gonna have sex, you know. And you have to wait until the end to know about that. So I don't think this is like a normal moral story. I think this is all a big joke that Barth does. And, you know, that's the way I see it.
It's like the literary version of the 40-year-old virgin, but much longer.
Exactly.
Much more exactly. I think that's interesting with the moral argument.
Much more complex. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, for sure. But with the moral stuff, too, it is interesting in both Sot-Weed Factor and in Joan Orpí that there are these philosophical discussions that relate to very pertinent social issues in both the time and that transpose and can be brought forward into our current moment. So when you talk about the role of women within society, that's still unchanging in many ways. And the way that this book treats it, it is still valid and still a moral situation that can be discussed, even if it's within the context of something that's broke and funny and you know, expansive and all these things and all these characters. At its core, there's a humanism that resides throughout these books that makes it not nihilistic, makes it not just a crazy game. There's still a human element. And that shows up in Joan Orpí a lot too, in terms of the relationship to slave owning and to the natives. I do think the moral joke is really funny of a virgin who's essentially colonizing part of America. That's kind of coming over to take it and to go to the virginal wild wilderness and create something is kind of funny for playing with that game, but it is interesting. So how was this?
I would say, and if I could tag on to what Max said, I would say very important in this book that the moral argument is but one of several elements.
Mm-hmm.
And in itself, ironic. In turn, I think Joan Toast does engage our sympathies.
Yeah.
We feel for her, but we can't pretend this is merely a feminist weeper. Of course not. It's not Maggie, a girl of the streets. I haven't read all of it, but I've read enough to get it. It's a bad life for Maggie. The moral aspect here is just one part of a very complex thing that also criticizes colonial exploitation, also criticizes slave owning, also lots of other.
Exactly. Arguments. But that's why I was telling these that these authors were accused of being cold and distant to social realities and nihilism. But that's all bullshit, because at the end, all these books, and especially the Sot-Weed Factor that we're talking about, of course, the book is talking about all these, how women were treated and how history was seen and all these things, all these real issues. Because Barth is writing this book under the black humor and under this made up language, 18th century language, that it has been seen by the critics as and when you do humoristic book, critics, they don't see that this is the book is talking about something real important, and if you take a look in the history of literature, the humor books are often seen it's more valuable a tragedy, and this goes since the ancient Greeks. The philosophers, the ancient Greek philosophers, they say tragedy is more important than comedy. Aristotle, they say that when he's doing the generous, they say tragedy is here and comic books, humor books are here, you're down below. But then when you see the history of literature, and especially the modern novel, you see that the greatest novels are often comic. Humor books, the Quixote, the Ulysses, Joyce, Tristram Shandy, Moby Dick, the Sot-Weed Factor, Gravity's Rainbow. It's all humor books. Of course they are difficult to read, and you need to spend some hours to read all these 1,000 pages. But if you can put your telephone and your computers away and you lock in a room, you're gonna have a lot of fun, you know, because they are, you know, humor books and they are made to laugh, you know. And then you can have second lecture, second readings on social criticism or the language or whatever. But first of all, they are humor books and a really good humor, you know, sense of humor.
I had to go.
I would say Gravity's Rainbow also generates tremendous sympathy. For example, Slothrop is reduced to a homeless wandering. A lost soul, and you care about them. I would say, you know, there's human beings in there and human problems. It's just
exactly
a lot of other stuff. Yeah,
very, very true. I had to lead a trip as a like a academic, whatever, through Iceland for a bunch of alumni earlier this year, and to do that, I prepared by reading a lot of like the sagas. And immediately, I think everyone's like, oh, Icelandic sagas, that's so boring. And like, you know, it's going to be this and that. The funniest shit I have ever read. Like, I was just like, this is hysterical. Like, then I think that there's always been humor as part of these grand works, but it tends to be overlooked. Like you say, it's like that you rather focus on the intensity and the veracity and the like, that part of it. Even like I judged a contest this year and the vast majority of those books just aren't funny. Like a lot of contemporary stuff is written to be deadly serious and be like completely earnest and not playful and not risky. And I mean, some of that, like this is a book that I'm curious to hear your story, John, that like theoretically, like this could be, you know, this is like on the verges of like, how do you get canceled by making these sorts of jokes? Like, I mean, like you made like everything's a little off color and a little bit in that gray area, and that's sort of where you can interrogate it.
We've been ignoring the enormous amount of attention paid to human bodily functions, right? This is one of the most excremental books ever written, isn't it? I guess we're all too nice to talk about the scene where Ebenezer needs something to wipe his ass, right? And he goes on for pages. He can't and mentions Rabelais, right? He said, Rabelais said you could use the neck of a goose. But
it's so funny because it is.
Yeah, but in Rabelais, you also find a lot of shit everywhere, you know, and excrement and I put in my novel, I put a lot of these too, because in my culture, the Catalan culture, the shit is everywhere. We make a lot of jokes with shit and, you know, and even for Christmas, we have, you know, something related to shit. And, you know, it's like, and probably this comes from Middle Ages where shit were all over, you know. In the street.
Aren't they called the little crappers? What are they, like those little figurines in Catalonia that are like of the be like famous people but like squatting down and like it cracks up. I love it. Like that freedom is there. That's wonderful. I'm curious, John.
Okay, go ahead.
Oh, sorry.
Your question. You wanted to hear my story.
I wanna know this. How is this book received and transitioned over the years, in your opinion? Like the sort of like it goes from being, I mean, when it comes out, I don't know how it was received, but I assume fairly well in terms of like his status and his place.
All that.
Yeah, and got the attention, got the reviews. He's like a big name among American letters. And then at some point it's out of print. And Dalkey is reissuing it like this, and then was reissued once. And then we had to just reissue it again because they were out of stock, but it also needed another boost. Like this sort of like a cyclical rediscovery of authors like this. I'm curious from your perspective of having like studied, knowing him, seeing this kind of progression of both the book's response and like his new works and how that influence like the way that he was seen as a writer. And I'm curious about that kind of history of it.
Well, I expect you know some of it. And Max, I don't know. It's interesting. I'm happy to talk about it. In the brief, the thumbnail version is that his reputation went downhill quite badly in the 80s and on right through the end of the most recent century. I have seen signs of some resuscitation. And part of that was my essay was, well, you've seen the essay I wrote in Lit Hub about John Barth and his later work, and that Lit Hub would allow such a piece to be published. I mean, that says something about a reconsideration. That's the short version. Sot-Weed Factor remained in print a long time. It remained in print into the 80s. And it's a horrible indictment of the American education system, but people don't get assigned long books anymore.
Nope.
I guess graduate students have to read it, but they don't get assigned long books anymore. And so it's a rare undergraduate, a rare anybody under the age of 25 who's reading something longer than I don't know, 200 pages, 250 pages.
Very true.
And this certainly affected the way it was known. John Barth was known only by inference, by secondhand knowledge. For what it's worth, Lost in the Funhouse, because it's short stories, is still taught some. And that particular story, Lost in the Funhouse, appears in a lot of anthologies. But it's, you know, that's just a piece, just the least little piece of his work. But that one still is there. Now, my general point holds. His reputation went downhill. A number of people they were really vicious in their attacks. Gore Vidal, awful attack, you know, unfounded on Barth's writing. Nobody reads him. Yeah. And then Barth did write in 1980, the next book after Chimera, and we can go to Chimera if you, next book after Chimera, the next original work was a long novel named Letters. It is long and difficult, there's no question. It's also quite beautiful. It's an amazing piece of work. And it would be another of the books that you could call his greatest. There's really nothing like it out there. But, you know, it is demanding, and, you know, he just got trashed for that. He followed it up with some excellent novels, and I talked about those. I could also talk about Chimera, but I'll end on a happier note. Out of nowhere, about, oh, God, this would be 10 years ago now. I was asked by the online literary magazine, literary presence. It's called Big Other. Mm-hmm. You've probably heard of it, Chad. Yep. It's run by a guy named John Madera. It's done a lot of good over the years in America. And they asked me to set up a reading, a sort of set up something on behalf of the Sot-Weed Factor. Oh. And I said, well, it shouldn't just be me. I'm a weary old geezer, you know, and of course I read the Sot-Weed Factor. It should be me and a younger person, ideally a younger woman. And he found someone to agree named Amber Sparks. Max, you'd like Amber Sparks' work if you find it. And Amber said, all right, I'll try it. And she was very impressed at first. She was very impressed. She said, wow, it's so full of life. And she's reading along. And this is a highly imaginative writer, highly intelligent writer. And it's in the Big Other archive somewhere. Mm-hmm. But she began to complain. She said, there's too much raping going on. Women are getting raped. And I said, Amber, please bear with it. You'll see that he's making a point. And then she arrived at Joan Toast's final. She saw how it was part of a whole vision of fractured, abusive history, colonial history, slave history, and of course the abuse of women. And she wound up appreciating it, and she's online, she's put it on a couple of lists of best older books that she's read. She's not that young, you know, she's 40, but still, that was a wonderful, affirming experience. She at first loved it. She got disturbed by the treatment of women, and then she hung in there and saw how that was part of the whole vision. Mm-hmm. So that was a very good experience, and I hope that's a nice story to share.
That's a great story to share. And that is like, it points to something that I think our culture today needs to be aware of, is that sometimes you have to go through things that are unpleasant to see the whole scope of them, rather than immediately rejecting something because of that sort of content, and to see where it fits in. It's interesting too, with Lost in the Funhouse, which is, I was taught that in college. Like, that was assigned in a college class, like the whole collection. And that was most of the students, I think, hated it. And it really, like, in some ways, it sort of pigeonholes Barth, where, like you say, it is the one that's in print. It is the one that gets, that always has remained in print the whole time, that's anthologized, that is like the marker, where it's like, okay, Barth, what is Barth? Barth is the one who wrote Lost in the Funhouse, where it questions the idea of fiction as an artifice, pulls the mimetic belief out from under you, and is therefore, that's it. That's the whole of it. That's the whole of his approach. And then when you read like Chimera or Sot-Weed Factor or other books of his, the real thing is that it's an endless storytelling is really where his basis is. And so like, yeah, you can question and pull out the artifice of fiction and of writing as a whole, and how things are not real and are this sort of construct. There's a gap between reality and the word. Form over content sort of vibe. But it's also like, how within that do you continue to spin a tale? How do you continue to make life interesting? How do you continue to capture all of these different nuances and ideas and fun and that, and just keep talking? The fact that he has so many books that are over 700 pages is wild. Like for a writer of any generation at any point in time, I mean, there's Sot-Weed, Letters is gigantic. Giles Goat Boy, also huge. Tidewater Tales, huge. I think the other one's really huge. The Collected Stories.
The Last Voyage of Somebody the Sailor is a little shorter, but it's 500 pages. You
know? Right, exactly.
700 pages, but it's long. You know?
Long. Like, the books are long, and there's like that literature of exhaustion element to it. But I think that too is kind of the core of like looking at the world and telling the stories about it and continuing to like generate, and that it isn't just that fiction as an artifice is an ending point. Fiction as an artifice is kind of the starting point of how you can continue to just create and create and create. So like, John, you go for it. You want to describe and talk about Chimera? You're on.
I talked an awful lot. Max deserves a crack at it. Did you read, do you know this one, Max, or?
No, I didn't read it.
I would like to hear just a bit. I'm happy to get into Chimera. But Max, can you tell us about how Barth is read and thought of, at least in if not in...
Well, the problem is in Spain, there were just a few translations in the 80s probably, on some books of Thomas Pynchon, I think The Recognitions from William Gaddis, some of Barthelme's short stories. And for example, this edition that I have from the Sot-Weed Factor is from the 90s, but it's, you can no longer find this edition. Now there's a new edition, but there is no, like, here there's like a foot pages that it explain, you know, a lot of things. It's like an academic book. But you know, all these authors, the postmodernism authors, they were not really read it in Spain back in time. And so you don't find many authors nowadays who are inspired by them, because there were no reception, and so there were no readers to these authors. And nowadays they are republishing these books by publishing houses from Mexico, but they are arriving in Spain. And so there's new readers who are reading these writers. I don't think there's a lot of readers, but still the books are still imprinting. So it's gonna be some readers who are somehow there will be influence and who will write inspired by them. But at least in Catalonia, my region, there's not so many writers who are influenced by those kind of readers. And I don't know. I think it was a constant back on those days that, you know, William Gaddis, Thomas Pynchon, John Barth, they had these never-ending books, right? And I think it was kind of a, you know, we're gonna write not the biggest American novel like Moby Dick, but we're gonna write thousands of them, right? And William Gaddis has, you know, the recognitions, J.R., a lot of huge books, and Pynchon has the Gravity's Rainbow, the Mason and Dixon, and Against the Day. You know, they are thousands and thousands of pages. That's crazy. I mean, as a writer, I would maybe write one novel of 1,000 pages in one lifetime, but not three. You know, that's crazy. And I think these kind of writers like John Barth and Thomas Pynchon has remained, as I said, for writers or for academics. And of course, as a reader, these kind of books demands not a passive reading, but an active reading, because, you know, you need to put all of your senses in the reading. And nowadays, this is difficult because, you know, it's not because the novels are shorter, but the novels, I think they tend to be simpler or more simple, right? And these kind of writers like John Barth or Thomas Pynchon demands a lot of attention from the readers. And this is a thing that I like, but maybe some readers, they don't like to put all this attention on one book, you know. Maybe nowadays it's just against the current, you know, because the fragmentation tends to, you know, to read just pieces of information here and there. And it's impossible to, you know, to concentrate in 1,000 pages novel. But I'm guessing that any reader that never heard of John Barth will enjoy, you know, reading this book, because it's a lot of fun. As I say, it's like to watch a Monty Python's movie, you know, but with 1,000 pages. What else do you want, you know?
The Monty Python connection.
So they exist as an ideal, as an inspiration, even if they aren't widely read.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but for example, David Foster Wallace, which is an author that I don't like very much, but he apparently he was very inspired by all those authors, right? And he himself wrote a huge novel, The Infinite Jest, and other novels, and he has a lot of readers, right? He has a lot of success and all of this. And I don't understand why he has all this attention and succeed, and John Barth or Robert Coover or William Gaddis remained in the shadows somehow, you know. But I guess
I have one more question along those lines, if I may ask. Now I know you read at least some of Lost in the Funhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And as I read that story, Lost in the Funhouse, it seems a very American story. It's very linked to a particular corner of an America at a particular time, the war in America. Mm-hmm. And yet it really worked for you. Can you talk about that, Max? And Chad, I don't mean to take you away.
You're great. You're gold.
I'd love to. Well, Max, how did you respond to that Lost in the Funhouse? I love it. I think it's a great story, but it seems very American to me. You?
Very American. Well, yeah, but the Sot-Weed Factor is very American too, because, you know, it even talks about Pocahontas, you know, which is the foundation of America itself, or at least the North America. I don't know. I don't think it's about, you know, when I read a good book, it's not about the nation or the nationality that it's been written, but how it's been written, right? So it's not about what it's about or the plot or the argument, but how it's written. I think that's the key of John Barth's book. You know, he writes in a way that you really feel that you are inside those stories, you know, and if you can commit to that, then you will enjoy the book for sure, you know, even if the Sot-Weed Factor or Lost in the Funhouse or whatever, you know, and it's not about the writer himself, but the stories the writer creates. Meanwhile, you know, the literature nowadays, it's more about the writer, I think, you know, it's more about me, myself. I think it's like, you know, it's like Instagram or all these social media, you know, that people talk just about themselves, you know. And, you know, that's why John Barth and some writers of his generation, they have been forgotten somehow, because they don't talk about themselves, you know, they just create stories. And that seems an old-fashioned thing to do in literature, which is a contradiction in its terms, right?
In a great story like Hoover's The Babysitter, you know that one? The Babysitter by Robert Hoover. Where is Robert Hoover?
Yeah.
He's not there. He's invented four or five other storylines. Maybe eight or nine other storylines, and he's not anywhere there.
Exactly.
Nor is John Barth in here, except that he also comes from that part of Maryland.
Exactly.
And even less so in Chimera. There's like no John Barth in that, which is the interesting book too, because it is the frame tales and the tales within the tales within the tales within the tales. That is to a lot of people like intimidating, like very intimidating. And yet this book, which is shorter than Sot-Weed Factor, but arguably a little bit equally or more dense to read, because you do have to piece the different levels of narration and understand like the kind of background myths that go along with it. But this is the one that wins the National Book Award, which seems like crazy in certain ways, like crazy as we're reprinting it and reissuing it. And for all these books, just to give a little bit of a peek behind the curtains for anyone who hasn't heard the story before, because of the way that the books were initially offset, we don't have any files to reprint them. So when the books ran out of stock, to have any of the Dalkey books reissued, we have been scanning them in and then retypesetting them so that then they can become a ebook, and that we have a digital file that can be transferred into future possible printings. Which, FYI, Sot-Weed Factor. Oh, Sot-Weed Factor is the hardest book that we have had to scan by far, by degrees of magnitude that I can't even begin to describe, because when you do a scan in an OCR, like the optical character recognition, it tries to make everything make sense. It tries to spell according to a dictionary. It tries to, so all of the apostrophes
are wrong.
All the FIs, F-I-E's become he's. Everything was wrong. To go through that, like, I'm certain there are still innumerable, like, discrepancies or mistakes that are within there, solely because like it was almost every single line, it would have been easier almost to retype it than it was to like read and try and fix it. But then you get so there's that. So then redoing Chimera, was when I was reading, I was like, This book is so miraculous and wonderful and interesting and so layered and so great. And I had one of my students read it too to proof it, and they really enjoyed it as well. But they're like, I don't understand this, but like I like it. And that, as an award winner, compared to Sot-Weed Factor, I'm like, Sot-Weed Factor is like a walk in the park reading it in many ways, because it is just fun. It is so verbal. They're both very verbal. They're very like storytelling books, oral books. But at the same time, there's like a more straightforward pattern. But I'd love to hear what you think of Chimera. And then also, if you want to jump from there, for anyone who is just new to Barth and is coming to Barth through this reissue of Sot-Weed Factor, which other books of his would you recommend aside that we haven't maybe mentioned so far?
I guess I better start with Chimera. And Max, I hope it's interesting for you. It is a very good book, Chimera. The time setting is the era of the 1001 Nights, though there's a visitor from the future, from the 20th century, at least, in the episode of the 7001 Nights. It involves Scheherazade, and Scheherazade is John Barth's great inspiration, for what it's worth. He loved Quixote, he knew it. But you want to talk about a long, complicated book, I would say his single favorite book is The 1001 Nights, translated into English with all the footnotes. He says, you've got to have all the footnotes because the footnotes explain all these startling details of what was meant by this reference or that reference. So Scheherazade is featured in one episode of Chimera, which is three novellas, or European style, three novellas. And then the other two are novellas built out of famous Greek myths. Mm-hmm. There is Perseus, and there is Bellerophon, but come on, what's the name of his? But Bellerophon, the flying horse, is the other one, and the man who rides him, it's up there on my shelf, but I don't want to.
Perseus
is the man who killed the Gorgon. And the man who rode the flying horse, Bellerophon, another Greek hero, a lesser Greek hero. Have you got it, Max?
I'm looking. I can't remember now.
Yeah, that's all right. But those are the other two novellas. They also get progressively stranger, I would say, stranger. That the Dunyazade, which is Dunyazade, was the sister of Scheherazade, and she is the narrator of the first one. And the sister of Scheherazade is a fascinating figure that nobody until John Barth ever thought of writing about.
Mm-hmm.
The sister of Scheherazade was present when Scheherazade was being first deflowered, telling the stories, saved night after night, giving birth, all that. The sister was there the whole time. And so her story is fascinating, but Barth was the guy that thought of it. And Barth had, this you probably read somewhere, Max, Barth had, at least for years, over his writing desk, I have over my writing desk a picture of my daughter drew of me 20 years ago, but no, 30 years ago, 35. But Barth had over his writing desk the word Scheherazade. Scheherazade means imagine, dream, think of something. Mm-hmm. And I like it better. But that's in various research, but it's a great inspiration up there. Various articles and that sort of thing mention that, but The Scheherazade story is fairly straightforward, especially in that it's told mostly from first event to last event. There are flashbacks, of course, but the next one gets stranger still. It involves longer flashbacks, stumbling on a room full of people who've all been turned to stone, for instance, by the Gorgon's Head. And then the third one is particularly swirling and winds up a long story of mistaken identification, not mistaken, deliberately hidden identification. The narrator is not really who he has been claiming to be all along. What's the word? False identification. Something straight out of Sot-Weed Factor. Now, all three are engaging on the level of story, and the Perseid is pretty serious. It's finally a love story, an unusual love story between Perseus and I'll just say that the lover who proves to be most important to him at the end of the story is a surprise. It's the last person you'd expect to be his lover, to very much a trompe l'oeil, trapayojo,
trampantojo,
trapadojo. And I have taught the Dunyad Zadiad successfully. Yeah, actually, come to think, I taught Chimera successfully once. But the Dunyad Zadiad especially really has worked for students. I would point out that the Dunyad Zadiad is also very much a feminist story, isn't it?
Yeah.
The heroes of the book are both the women. They're saving their own lives and they're elevating the status of women in their culture. And you don't notice it because it's so entertaining, which is true of the Sot-Weed Factor. Yeah, he is making an argument about the mistreatment of women. And we didn't even see it behind all the fast moving jokes and literary thing. But yes, it's there. It startles you. What else could I tell you without giving away too much? I guess it's pertinent that there was a lot of discussion about what the parent, and Barth has also explained all this in interview, but there was a lot of discussion before the book appeared about the sequence the book that he should appear in. And critics have written about this too. I'm perfectly fine with the sequence. I see it as making a logical progression. It starts out more straightforward and gets stranger and stranger. And the final surprise, the final trapallejo in the Bellerophonia strikes me as an excellent final vision of a confusing disease, confusing world full of disguises. Here's this from the end of Sot-Weed Factor, because I don't want to leave Max out of the discussion of Chimera, but this from the end of Sot-Weed Factor is right for the end of Chimera as well. The author intrudes again, right? The author defends his Sot-Weed Factor to a certain stodgy variety of squint-minded antiquarians who say, this isn't really history. And he says, we all invent our past as we go along. The happenings of former time are a clay in the present moment that will we, nil we, the lot of us must sculpt. And that happens again at the end of Chimera. You say, oh, that's who this is. And Chimera also has a lot of concern with, well, what is a hero anyway? What is a a Greek hero. Yeah. Is Perseus a hero when he slays the Medusa? Is he a hero? We meet him later in life when he's on that circle of the heroic journey where he's fallen and he wanders the countryside devouring his insides, I think was the word, the expression used. But yeah, there's a lot, that hero's journey is discussed a lot. And what is a real hero anyway? Maybe Perseus is more heroic when he's older and fallen. These are fascinating elements at work there. It's quite erotic. There are direct descriptions of sex, both good sex and bad sex in there. There's just a touch of homosexuality as well, but sex is very much a part of the plot in all three novellas. And I think it's very, very good, and it's very strange that it won the NBA. There are the National Book Award in America. There are a lot of theories about this. One of them is, well, everybody knows he should have won it for the two previous or three previous books. Uh-huh. So kind of recognition that he's changed literature. But it was after that his reputation began. His hero's journey went into its down cycle. And I think that's unfair. I think he continued to do great work all the way into the 1990s. How's that?
That's perfect. That's perfect. So
and I'm not really sure what other great books it was up against. It shared the award with a very different sort of book, a very quiet academic novel, very realistic.
Yeah.
Whose name I don't remember.
Augustus by John Williams.
Yeah, Augustus by John Williams. And in the same way that Thomas Pynchon had to share his award with a very different sort of book from Gravity's Rainbow. That was the halcyon period of the postmodernists, Max. They won a lot of the major awards there at the beginning of the 70s. Mm-hmm. And J.R. by Gaddis won in 75 in the heat. And I'll bet my grocery money that was in fact the best book of that year.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It is interesting.
So, but how am I doing on Chimera? Am I covered?
That's perfect. That's absolutely perfect. So for anyone listening, you have two recent reissues of Barth's books with Sot-Weed Factor and Chimera to check out. And there are still a number of books in Dalkey's catalog, including the early ones. I just had everything here and I blanked out. Including
the early opera. One.
Yes, Floating Opera, End of the Road.
End of the Road.
And we also have like Sabbatical, Letters, Tidewater Tales, big one, big thick one.
Big one, and an excellent book. Excellent book, Tidewater Tales. And here's the one I have lately been telling people to start with, The Last Voyage of Somebody, the Sailor, which takes them back to the era of the 1001 Nights. Sinbad is a major character, Sinbad and his daughter. Mm-hmm. And it's also a very erotic book. Lots of good sex in that one, and funny and strange, and visions of the afterlife figure in there. It's quite a book. I recommend it to
people. We We didn't mention the another book from John Barth that I read. It's the Giles, the Goat Boy.
Oh, Giles, Goat Boy, sure.
Which is an academic novel, and I read it because I put it in my PhD research, and it's so crazy novel too. Huh? It's a very crazy novel.
How did that one work for you? The computer that ate the world.
Exactly. There's a huge computer in the campus, and then in the same campus, it's like the whole world. You have the Russia and the United States, and you know, and also there's the questioning of a hero, Gilles. It's the son of a goat, and he has a quest, but he doesn't know what is about this quest, and it's quite a yeah. It's more I think it's more difficult to read than the Sot-Weed Factor, but for me it was very important because I was researching the academic novels, and this one probably is the most crazy academic novel I ever read in my life, and I think it's the best one. Yeah, I love John Barth.
Well, that's probably a good place for us to kind of wrap this up now that we've been talking for a while with which was the first book I read after Lost in the Funhouse was Giles Goat Boy, which I absolutely loved. Anything that kind of pokes a little fun at academia is good in my book. Love it. And he is very funny and very fun. And you can pick up the books at better bookstores everywhere or through Dalkey's website. Anything else that you guys want to plug on your way out? John, where can people get your books? Tell us about your most recent book.
My most recent book is, I'm not sure it's something John Barth would like. This is a memoir. This is about looking in the mirror, but it's called, let's see if I can get a copy here. It's called The Archeology of a Good Ràgu, Discovering Naples, My Father and Myself. After my father's death, as he was dying, and then after his death, I found out some secrets about him and my Naples family. Naples itself is a fascinating story. So that's my latest. I have novels, and probably my most Barthian stuff. I have Naples novels. This is the latest Naples novel. It's called The Color Inside a Melon. That's on Zank Books, which some of your listeners might know of. Also on Zank's is Moviola, the book we mentioned earlier, and some people like it a lot, and that's kind of Barthian. Sure, that's got some stuff that's funny and strange like Barth, and I'd love it if anybody read it.
Absolutely. We'll have links to in the show notes. We'll have links to everything and to John's website, and with you, Max.
My website. Yeah,
I know, Max. I'll sort of speak for you for one second in that you can pick up the Joan Orpí book from Open Letter Books, which will be publishing The Fake Muse next fall. We just received the translation literally yesterday. So we have the next Max Besora book is in the queue and in the pipeline. Anything else you want to say, Max, before we go?
No, not really. It was a really good time, and I hope the readers will read the Sot-Weed Factor and they will enjoy it for sure.
Absolutely. So if you're listening to this on the day that it comes out, you'll notice that on 3%, there'll be a number of Barth related things this week, including part of Max's introduction, excerpts from some of the books, and just a general overview. So enjoy all that. Stay tuned. We'll have another episode coming out in a few weeks, and rate, review, listen, tell your friends, do all that fun stuff that I'm never good at saying. So take care. Thank you both for doing this. This is really fun.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Max. Wonderful to meet you.
Yeah, me too.
Get over there. Or next time I'm in Naples, why don't you come to Naples?
That's a good point. Yeah.
A nice beach. And say it is not so.